The members of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, gravely concerned over increasing Soviet military power, gathered in Paris in December 1957 for a crucial conference. From the United States came President Dwight David Eisenhower, whose presence at this critical time gave the nations of Western Europe new hope. For Ike, this was a homecoming. At the headquarters of SHAPE, the military arm of NATO, located outside Paris, the former commander of the North Atlantic Military Forces, now president of one of NATO's most powerful member nations, declared his mission before the large crowd which had gathered to greet him.
Frankly, I came out here because of a special kind of sickness, one that afflicts the aged and the young, homesickness. I was homesick to see this home that was built for SACEUR and his staff, an agency of NATO. This home was built by a great number of nations to be the headquarters of that military shield that must always belong to NATO so long as there is any menace to the freedom of the Western nations.
And now, once more, at the Palais de Chaillot, which housed the Western world's hopes for peace, they gathered. The men of goodwill who bore their people's mandate for freedom. This was the first NATO meeting attended by the heads of the 15 member states. This was a summit conference calling for highest level consultation. Basically, two critical tasks had to be accomplished: to shore up NATO and to counteract an intensified Soviet propaganda offensive. A major interest of the United States in the NATO meeting was the question of integrating into Western defense the intermediate range ballistic missile as a deterrent to the Soviets, whose long range missile had for the moment thrown a shadow over the world. The 15 heads of states attending this vital NATO meeting represented 450 million people, whose lands covered a total of almost 8 million square miles of the Earth's surface. Differences were to be expected, but on one point there was complete agreement. The core of the NATO partnership: an attack against one was an attack against all. In order to live in peace together, all were resolved to defend themselves together if necessary. Many of the nations of Western Europe felt that political, not military, action was the answer to the latest Soviet threat. Others believed that NATO should be interested as well in broader problems and looked to the United States for support of their national positions. President Eisenhower's words were the high point of the conference. There was no mistaking Ike's sincerity and determination as he spoke.
We have demonstrated a will for the spreading of the blessings of liberty. Within the last 15 years, our nations have freely granted political independence to 20 countries with populations totaling 800 million people. Within our societies, we manifest so that all can see the good fruits of freedom. Those fruits do not consist of materialistic monuments, which despots have always been able to exhibit. They consist of providing the simple things all men want: the opportunity to think and worship as their conscience and reason dictate, to live in their homes without fear, to draw together in the intimacies of family life, to work in congenial tasks of their own choice, and to enjoy the fruits of their labor. These are the most precious manifestations of freedom, and we have the collective power to defend and spread that freedom. Freedom has not failed us. Surely we shall not fail freedom.
Perhaps the chief result of this summit meeting was the expansion of NATO into a broader, more realistic alliance, in keeping with the ever-increasing complexity of problems facing it. A special responsibility rested on these representatives of the Atlantic community. Within their lands, freedom first had its birth. Within their borders lay three-fourths of the world's institutions of higher learning, and the title, deeds, and monuments of Western culture and civilization. To the men who met at this summit conference of NATO, there was no doubt that the North Atlantic Treaty Organization must continue stronger than ever. For the existence of NATO is an assurance that each new dawn breaks over our family of nations at peace, over the countryside, cities and homes of a community of peace-loving people, over London and Liverpool, Paris and Marseille, New York and San Francisco, Montreal and Vancouver, over Athens, Istanbul, Rome, Lisbon and Reykjavik, over Antwerp, Bonn and Luxembourg. A bond welding the old world and the new. An assurance that 450 million people remain free to live their lives as they wish to live them. To protect and preserve by vigilance and readiness. These are the aims of the Atlantic Alliance. An alliance for peace.
Today on The Big Picture, you have heard the distinguished news analyst Edward R. Murrow tell the story of NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. The United States, as a founding member of this vital international body, has demonstrated to the world the importance we place on the closest association between the members of the Atlantic community. Now, this is Sergeant Stuart Queen, your host for The Big Picture.
The Big Picture is an official television report for the armed forces and the American people. Produced by the Army Pictorial Center. Presented by the United States Army in cooperation with this station.